Yeah, Len's been a plant pathologist for a number of years with a focus on vegetable production and particularly on Pythium. So it'll be great to learn from Len and for him to share his experience. Thanks, Len.
Thanks. Okay, so let's begin. What are we going to do today? Well, I thought there were kind of three questions that we'd like to answer. What sort of microbes are Pythium? And I guess that came from the masterclass when we talked about life cycles and how there may be ways of intervening to break that life cycle in terms of control. So we'll sort of get a bit of background on what Pythium is. Why are they important? I'll go through that. And then effective management. And that's where there's a number of options. It'll be very interesting to get your feedback as to how and how many of those, I suppose, are useful to you in your particular situation. Genetically, Pythium is, it was thought to be a fungus for many years, although the guy that first described it, Nathaniel Primsheim, he actually noticed that it actually shared a lot of features with algae. And so curiously, it's taken a long time, but in more recent years, it's been shown to have, common ancestors with things like the brown algae. So it's not a true fungus. It's more in the plant kingdom than the fungi, which are more in the animal kingdom. There's about 150 species, although you can read some reports and there's maybe up to 300 that have been described. So there's been a lot of work that sort of lumpers and splitters have defined species sometimes a bit too quickly, and others have tried to lump them very easily. So I'd say about 150 known species, although new ones are coming along all the time. And in fact, some Japanese researchers recently showed that Pythium could be split into five genera. So they're quite diverse genetically, even within that group. They've got diverse life cycles and lifestyles. So some of them are plant pathogens that we talk about. Others are just what we call saprophytes, living on dead tissue. Some attack algae, so they actually infect algae in the ocean or in fresh water. Some attacked insects. There's even one that attacks horses, and that can also get into humans. So they can be human pathogens, or very rarely, but human pathogens. And I'll talk a little bit more about their lifestyles as well. Key features, for someone like myself, are the filaments on these little motile spores that are produced. And you can see there on the left those little packet of marbles there, which are the little things called zoospores. So they're swimming spores, and they've got this very curious feature, which is this anterior flagellum, and it's got those little hairs, and that actually propels the zoospore through the medium, and makes it it's quite an energy taxing event, but it means that these things can move through liquid medium, and they're chemically and electrically attracted to things like roots. So I've got to go to the life cycle first. But anyway, so that's the way the little zoospores move through liquid and then find their way to the root where they infect. So I'm just going to go through the life cycle now. And you can see that those structures there, those oogonia, are the sexual spores. And they can come along. I'll just open this right up. So there's the sexual phase of the life cycle where you get an infection, produces those sexual spores, which produce a thing called an oospore, and that's down on the bottom right-hand side there. You can see that oospore inside. So they're very resistant. They can survive in soils for maybe up to 15 years or more. So they're very, very resilient. Some of them, other species, they're shorter lived. And then they can go through that motile phase. Some species, though, don't actually have a sexual phase, and some don't have that motile phase with the zoospores. So it kind of depends on which species you have as to which way they they will infect. But generally, the oospore itself can germinate, forming hyphae, and then cause infection directly. So that's that bit of up right up the middle there of the first circle up on the top. Otherwise, they can go right around through the swimming spore stage, the zoospore stage. So that's their life cycle, and I'll talk a little bit more about interventions as we go through. Here's a couple of pictures, and quite a lot of those zoospores, when they infect, are attracted to the root tips, and that's why things like very small seedlings, where there's leaky little root tips, or even germinating seeds, can be infected very quickly, because there's that chemoelectric attraction that they have to that area just around the just behind the root cap itself, called the zone of elongation, where a lot of nutrients are released into that sort of area we call the rhizosphere. The one on the right there, you can see that little zoospores are attacking a piece of root tissue, and where there's damage to a root, that's where they can also be attracted. So again, there's that leakiness of plant tissue and various things like amino acids and things that are coming out that are attracting those zoospores. So why are they important? Okay, so they're very common in soils and water. They're found in native soils as well as agricultural soils. They're found in water, and that's another key for people to remember, using dam water and the like. They can affect all growth stages of plant development. So we quite often think of them as just being something that attacks seedlings or even seed before it's germinated in the ground, but they can attack older plants as well. And they can attack a wide range of crops. Some are specialised to certain botanical groups of plants, and I'll go on into that a little bit later, but others have got a very wide host range, so crop rotation isn't really an option for them, for their control. They can breed quickly, and as you can see from those pictures of the zoospores forming, that can all happen in about half an hour. So you can get a population of Pythium that multiplies by a thousandfold within an hour or so. And also, and this is one of the areas of my research, has been that they're synergists with other plant pathogens and pests in disease complexes. And there's many, many reports on this. So in some cases, things like Pythium and Fusarium get together and cause disease complexes, and I studied that for my PhD in cucumbers, but that is known in peas, and there's other complexes that form with nematodes. Quite often they form complexes with each other. Sometimes you'll get maybe six or seven species of Pythium in the one diseased plant. And some of the other interesting stuff I found was that they can be synergists with certain herbicides, for example, glyphosate, and that's become a bit topical at the moment because there's a bit of research going on showing that you can get glyphosate residues in sandy soils under dry conditions. So you think about, the paper that I read was showing that where you were controlling weeds and you had Pythium present, the weeds would die quicker. But if you've got residues of glyphosate, there's a chance that actually with Pythium present, you might actually be affecting your plant growth a bit. So that's something to consider for future work, but it's something that's been published and is worth looking at. What sort of types of plant diseases? So I mentioned seed decay, pre-emergent damping off for those people who are planting seed. Seedlings and post-transplant damping off, that's probably one of the most common things. Root rot of feeder roots, and that can occur in all sorts of plants at any age. Quite often, you'll see in the damping off phase, particularly a hypocotyl rot. The hypocotyl is that area just between the cotyledons and the ground, and so Pythium can move up above the ground in that tissue. So it's not just in the root system. It can also get into fruit, and quite often in the past in particular, without post-harvest treatments, you'd get fruit rots of things like cucumbers and the like. Disease called cottony leek is one particular one, but many other diseases. Gets into potato tubers as well. Replant diseases of woody plants, not so important with our vegetable group, but I'll be talking to blueberry growers next week about replanting blueberries, and that's a bit of a problem for them. And then, as I was saying, those wilt disease complexes, when they interact with things like fusarium wilt diseases. So there's a couple of specific cases I'll mention in a minute. And in fact, even leaf blight and plant collapse. And I've had an example recently with a pythium that gets into lettuces. In fact, there's a couple of pythiums that get into lettuces and can blight the leaves and cause post-transplant disease and quite often death. Okay, so just looking at the seedlings, and that case on the right there you can see is pretty typical, where you've got plants that are keeling over and dying, and quite often in a situation like that, it'll go right through the tray, and that's just a group of plants that I was growing once in a greenhouse, and I ended up getting that disease in intentionally. The slide on the left, though, is important for you to see that quite often you wouldn't even know that Pythium is affecting your plants. And you can see those two petri dishes with lettuce seedlings in them. The ones on the right are infected with Pythium on the right, whereas the ones on the left are healthy. And you can see the difference in the root systems that are being formed. So there's far fewer feeder roots there on the right. And you may detect a slight discoloration of those affected plants as well. So they're, and of course the size of the plants, but other than that, if you had a whole uniform group of plants like that, you wouldn't even know they had the infection. Carrot growers probably know all about this disease, cavity spot, so affecting the taproot. Many years ago, I found Pythium, similar species of Pythium, attacking carrot seedlings and causing forking. So it's not just cavity spot that's an issue. Sometimes forking of carrots is also a problem caused by Pythium, where it's attacked the primary taproot at a very young age. Getting back to complexes, one that I've found and looked at quite a bit in recent years is baby spinach. And I found up to four different genera of pathogens associated with spinach problems, so Pythium along with Fusarium, and that particular Fusarium I was able to demonstrate is a Fusarium wilt disease causing Fusarium. Phytophthora, at least one species of Phytophthora, and Rhizoctonia, which again attacks the collar region. So without knowing, you might assume that your plants have got Pythium, but sometimes they may have one or all of those different pathogens, and of course your management strategies may vary depending upon which you have or if you have all of them. Here's a couple of others in soilless systems, collapsing lettuce and in cucumbers in sawdust substrate in that case, and again water is the key, the Pythium coming in on the water, supplied to those plants. Here's that one I was mentioning earlier about where the Pythium can come up above the ground, and in this case, this is a lettuce seedling affected by this Pythium uncinulatum, and you may just be able to see I've put a agar block on one of the leaves, and that is probably not the worst of the plants, but that plant collapsed within a day, and many of the others had already collapsed when I took that photo. So it's a kind of a seedling disease, but it's one where the Pythium is actually right up in the leaf as well as being down in the roots. So what factors affect the severity of disease? And of course genetics. There's no real genetic resistance like we have with, say, Fusarium wilt in many of the vegetable species. You might have some what we might call horizontal resistance, where there's features of the plant, probably several genes that give rise to a plant that's more able to resist disease, but not completely resistant. The inoculum density is important, so that's been shown in many experiments. So the amount of Pythium, say how much of those oospores you have, or the little zoospores that encyst per gram of soil, can obviously affect the amount of disease that comes along. The temperature, and some species are what we call warm temperature species and others are cool temperature species. I'll show you that in one of the next slides. Light intensity can be important. I remember a case where a melon grower had planted early in the season, so they'd had cloudy weather, cool temperatures, and a lot of the melon seedlings succumbed to Pythium, and it was probably a combination of soil moisture, temperature, and light intensity. I mentioned in that slide where I showed those zoospores affecting the root that insects and physical damage can be important, and in particular sciarid flies and shore flies that are very common around vegetable crops, particularly in high organic matter or in the case where people are using various substrates in soilless systems. But sciarid flies have been shown to actually ingest Pythium spores and excrete them as well. So they're a particular case of being able to spread the thing around, but of course the maggot stage of those flies also damage roots, so that's a really important area. Nutrition is important, and I'll go into that in another slide. Soil aeration is important. Pythium tends to tolerate low aeration conditions around the root zone better than other, what you might call beneficial organisms. So they can outcompete other organisms during periods of high soil moisture. And pH can be important, although I wouldn't consider it to be one of the most important, but they're all factors. Let's look at temperature, and different species have different, preferences. So those couple at the top, Pythium irregulari and Pythium ultimum, there's a little typo there, they can grow at about 5 degrees, and Pythium sulcatum, the one that causes cavity spotting carrots, it can grow down to about 2 degrees. So those cool soil temperatures can be very important, because these guys can not just survive but actually grow at those temperatures. But the upper limits also change, and you can see as you go down the list, Pythium aphanidomatum and Pythium myriatilum, they like temperatures above 30 degrees, and so they can actually be present in root systems at lower temperatures but not cause disease. And you can see that with Pythium myriatilum in that picture below, where at 20 and 30 degrees you can start to see a little bit of damage, but at 40 degrees quite a lot of damage. So we were able to show in that case that there was a very strong interaction with Pythium myriatilum, and the same goes for Pythium aphanidomatum. So what else can I say there? Some others are in between those. So Pythium mastiforum, which attacks lettuces, and Pythium spinosum, which is a high, sort of 5 degrees to 35 degrees, it can attack lots of different plants at any one of those temperatures. In terms of host range, I've already mentioned Pythium sulcatum and mastiforum. They're generally only in the carrot family, so you'll find them associated with diseases in things like carrots. I've been working on parsley root rot disease and just picked up Pythium mastiforum on carrots. And strangely enough, I was looking at flannel flowers, which happened to be in the Apiaceae family as well, and they were affected by Pythium mastiforum. Virtually all vegetables are attacked by Pythium aphanidomatum. I think it's probably the most aggressive of all the Pythium species, although it does have that high temperature requirement, and some of those other species, irregulari, ultimum and spinosum, you'll find them in lots of different veggies. And then in the lettuce family, that's Pythium trachyphyllum, which has only really been found in WA and Victoria, and Pythium uncinulatum, one I mentioned earlier, that gets up into the leaves. Both of those get up into the leaves of lettuces, but they can also attack a few other plants. So let's look at some controls, and we'll start with chemicals only because historically that's what people, always felt was the easiest way of controlling them. And fumigation, although effective, has a lot of downsides, and I'll go through those in a minute. In terms of chemicals, you don't have a lot of options really. Metalaxyl has been the chosen one, so it's used as apron, as a seed dressing, and sometimes as an in-furrow treatment. But again, it's one of those chemicals that's been used a lot in the past. And if you go to the bottom of that slide there, enhanced biodegradation, over in WA they show that where they'd been using it in carrots, the half-life went from 82 days, so that's sort of, the half-life means how long it takes for half of the chemical to disappear. It went from 82 days down to 4 days, so that means it's basically food for bacteria. Some of those other chemicals aren't really available for vegetable growers, although some of them are registered overseas for that. And there are some new ones in development, so that's maybe something to watch out for. But the key problems are, particularly we know about fumigation, there's this rapid recolonisation by Pythium after fumigation has taken place. So it gets in pretty quickly, and particularly given that it's spread with water, obviously it'll come back in very easily. Resistance selection, not something we see or have even researched in Australia, but overseas it's been shown that metalaxyl resistance has occurred in Pythium populations, and that enhanced biodegradation I think is the key one where it's been demonstrated in Australia. There are some reduced risk chemical controls, and in particular there's a lot of literature on enhancing calcium levels in plants. So supplementing fertilisers with calcium and to some extent magnesium have been shown. And I guess in a similar way, exchangeable cations in the soil have been shown. So where you've got, again, soils that have got a higher exchangeable cation level, then you'll get less Pythium disease. And that's been demonstrated many times. And then there's these products that we call induced systemic resistance activators. So chitosan is one, which is a kind of a product that comes out of shellfish in particular. And I think there are a couple of products available. Soluble silicates is another one. So there's products on the market where there's, I guess, what they call soluble salts of silica. Generally, silica, as you know, is being in sand, is insoluble, and those products stimulate the plant defences. I guess another one you could throw in there is things like phosphonic acid, which is used on a number of crops. And then there's these things called biosurfactants, which are basically detergents that are produced by some bacteria. And I've noticed there's at least one product available on the market that they've obviously been able to manufacture from a bacterial source, these rhamnolipids. When we get to some of the other biological controls, you'll see that they produce those anyway. So biocontrols, some produce antibiotics, so of course they will disrupt all the stages in that life cycle. So things like Bacillus and Pseudomonas bacteria are good examples of those sorts of things. Streptomyces is another one. Some are also parasites, so trichoderma species that in a lot of products will actually parasitize Pythium and sometimes the oospores, so it'll knock down your inoculum population in the soil, and Streptomyces will do the same. Then there's things called zoospore interferers, those swimming spores. And what they do is they reduce the attraction, the encystment and the germination of those. So a lot of what we call the fluorescent pseudomonad species, various bacteria, and again those biodetergents, products that I mentioned in the previous slide, they help dissolve away the flagella, which are those tails that those things have. And also the actual zoospore itself has a very thin wall, so it gets dissolved away by those detergents, so it actually knocks them out before they even find the plant. And then of course there's those inducers of systemic resistance. So many of those bacteria and fungi listed there have been shown to induce systemic resistance, a bit like the silica and the chitosan in the previous slide. Many of them are competitors for nutrition on the root surface in that rhizosphere, we call it, and they produce enzymes that degrade the Pythium cell walls. So that Pythium oligandrum, so there's two species there of Pythium that actually attack other species of Pythium. Some of them are actually what we call hyperparasites, but the mechanisms by which they work tend to be that they produce these enzymes or excrete enzymes that degrade Pythium cell walls. So more or less then use the breakdown products of those other Pythiums as food. So they're able to basically feed on their brothers. Properties of biocontrols are really important to understand because I guess a lot of people try these things and they don't always find they succeed. And there's also a lot of things that are used by people, particularly compost teas and the like, where I guess the components aren't really well defined. And so you can't just sort of grab any bacillus species or any pseudomonas species and think that it's going to be a useful biocontrol, because they've got to have this thing called rhizosphere competence. They've got to be able to colonize, compete against other organisms, and be, I guess, be able to sustain that. And what can happen sometimes is that you can get this thing in bacteria in particular where you can get down regulation of things like antibiotic production. So instead of them actually, you know, they might colonize okay, but for some reason other bacteria send a signal out which means they stop producing those antibiotics that are killing off the others. You also need an inoculant delivery system, so it needs to be formulated. Obviously they're biological, so they have a limited shelf life, they've got to be stored appropriately. And you need a use pattern. Should they be applied to seed? Should they be applied through the irrigation system? All those sorts of things need to be worked out. And then finally, their environmental impact. And I guess there's some amazing papers on some Pseudomonas species that are good biological control agents, but unfortunately, they're also potential human pathogens. So they've got relatives that have been found as human pathogens, and that's probably not a desirable thing. I think Pseudomonas putida might be one example of that. So let's look at some cultural controls, because I really think this is where your best bang for your buck is going to be. Using fresh seeds is really important. So physiologically aged seed is more susceptible to Pythium attack. And the reason is that older seed actually is more leaky and therefore more attractive to those Pythium spores. Priming seed's really important. Now again, priming seed is something you need to talk to your seed merchant about or your seedling producer, because you can just do a basic priming of seed by imbibing them in water prior to sowing. But there's many proprietary priming systems people use, and it's been shown that again, by getting quicker germination of your seed, you will actually improve the chances of them resisting a lot of Pythium disease. So that slowing down of that germination process is the thing that means that they're more susceptible. Improving drainage and irrigation scheduling is obviously important. And again, remembering that those motile spores are going to be around during that soil wet soil condition, but also I guess with drainage is that lower oxygen problem that is more attractive, or at least it allows Pythium to outcompete where it generally wouldn't. And water disinfection, which is probably something that's overlooked by a lot of people. So again, if you're using stored water supplies from dams and the like, there's most likely going to be some Pythium species in that water. So some disinfection process is best. Other cultural controls is scheduling your sowing times or transplanting dates to avoid temperature extremes. And again, I mentioned that case of the melon seed going in early in the year, and I know sometimes it's attractive to try and get a crop through at an earlier time where you might get a bit more money for it, but there's a risk involved in that. So sometimes scheduling based on the best objective data you have about what the temperatures are can avoid certain Pythium diseases. So again, in the cold and in the heat, those extremes are important. Rotating crops to less susceptible hosts, and again, that won't help you with some species of Pythium, but it will with others. So again, it depends on which species you're dealing with. using cover crops or and or biofumigants. So I know a lot of people have been using these things more recently, and there's clearly evidence to show that that will do a few things. It'll knock down the Pythium population, but it'll also increase the population of other beneficial organisms that are there. So they'll outcompete Pythium in those circumstances. Composts, making sure they're stabilised or mature is really important, because if they're not, they'll be unstable and Pythium will actually grow saprophytically on them. So you won't always get a control with compost if it's not mature. And adding growth promoting chemicals. So again, there's lots of products on the market that purport to have some sort of pseudo hormonal action, and so they're obviously going to increase the growth rate of the plant, giving you a healthier root system, which hopefully will give the plant I guess more root system and hopefully less affected by Pythium. So in summary, I guess being a diagnostic plant pathologist, I have to say having your diseases diagnosed correctly, remembering what I said about those disease complexes. And in some cases, I've found Pythium wasn't even involved in situations where people thought they had a Pythium problem. So that can be very important. Knowing your species can be important, as I said, in terms of choosing rotation crops and the like. Using integrated strategies to manage disease, so again, looking at, you know, chemical, biological, and some of those cultural approaches we just mentioned. Objectively trialing new products and strategies. So of course, when you when the salesman comes and gives you something or sells you something, don't just put it on and don't have a, you know, the idea is have a control area where you haven't treated, so you can actually get a bit of information straight away as to whether or not the product is helping or not. And remembering that biological controls, those microbial biocontrols, they're protectants and they're far less effective once the plants are diseased. So you've really got to get them in there from day one. You can't expect them to do what I guess we used to use some of the agrochemicals to do for us. So I think that probably summarises everything I have to say. Just some acknowledgements. Shannon, who helped me get this presentation together. My collaborators here at AHR and RMCG. And the projects that are funded by HIA and AusVeg.
Excellent.
So hopefully we've got some questions.
Yeah, thank you, Len. That went remarkably well and a great delivery too. It's difficult because we're just staring at a blank screen, so it does get hard to sort of realise that you are talking to a whole range of people. So we've got a couple of questions, and again, if you've got any others that you'd like to ask, please do so through the little dialogue box there, the question box. We've got one that Lawrence from down in Tassie asked, and that was...
Hi, Lawrence.
And that was about the effectiveness of rotations, and he was had a question was that rotation, is rotation not necessarily a good control measure with Pythium?
And again, it comes down to what species you're dealing with. So those species that I mentioned that have a wide host range, they'll be there for the whole rotation. It doesn't matter what you do. So Pythium ultimum, Pythium irregulari, they're the cool temperature Pythiums, and they're very difficult to eradicate by any means, but rotations probably won't affect them very much. Same with Pythium aphanidomatum, and that's a warm temperature Pythium. Mm. And I've seen situations where, you know, you can go from summer and you'll find Pythium aphanidomatum has been the dominant cause of disease, and then in wintertime, Pythium irregulari will be the dominant one, or Pythium ultimum.
So just a little follow-on from that is, you said that the Pythium can multiply up in 1 hour by thousands, so actually reducing inoculum, do you think that's going to be that effective if you can get that sort of multiplication up to higher levels?
There's always a critical mass in terms of, it's a bit like anything, it's exponential. So when you've got very little, even doubling it isn't going to be a lot more. It's only once you get sort of past that point of no return where they'll really move very quickly. So very low levels, you know, they won't be doing that sort of thing, whereas very high levels. So you need quite often about 10,000 little spores, or what we call colony forming units, per gram of soil, which sounds like a lot, but these things are only tiny, and I can tell you that they're generally there in spades. So knocking that population right down can be really useful. And then of course you've got all these other biological factors, that there's all these organisms that live in the soil that will be taxing that Pythium population all the time anyway. And some of those encysted zoospores don't last as long, so it might be a temporal thing where the population will go up really quickly for a short amount of time and then it'll go back down again. So it'll fluctuate quite a bit. And of course, with all the other factors like temperature and moisture in the soil, they'll fluctuate. They won't stay stable.
So in terms of having a sort of diagnostic test for the soil, do you think that's a way that the soil-borne disease project will go?
I think we need to try it. I think it's something we've got to try, but there's a number of issues, and I must admit a bit of a skeptic, because there's a lot of factors that I know from the literature that kind of make me think, oh, is it going to be useful? For example, when I look at one species, Pythium ultimum, I've got isolates of Pythium ultimum, same species. Some are really aggressive pathogens and others are hardly pathogenic at all. So you've got this kind of variation. So somehow we're going to have to deal with all of the biological variation that's out there. And it may mean that, you know, in a sense, your particular enterprise needs to calibrate what the results mean for your enterprise and the populations that you've got on that enterprise, rather than sort of this more generic thing that's going to be Australia-wide. Mm. So I really think that it's worth doing. I just think we need to kind of be mindful that there's a lot of issues associated with any soil-borne pathogen in terms of where it is geographically, how it changes over time, what intraspecific variation there is, how it can form complexes with other organisms. So it may be only when it's present with another organism that it becomes a major problem. So, you know, there's lots to consider, but it's we've got to start somewhere.
Yeah. So the SoilWealth and ICP team will be working closely with the Sardi lab with their project to look at the molecular techniques for doing the diagnostics and just getting a risk framework together to interpret those tests. We're going to jump up to Bundaberg now, and a question from Neil on capsicums, and he's basically saying that, you know, what's your sort of best case scenario or best management practice when you've got a slow establishing crop like capsicums, mm-hmm. In terms of poor early root growth and trying to control Pythium.
Okay, so again, all those cultural factors. I think Pythium myriatilum and Pythium aphanidomatum will be the main candidates. So they're the warm temperature Pythiums, and they're quite aggressive pathogens. So they're probably the hardest to deal with in terms of any sort of management, because they are very aggressive and they form lots of zoospores, so they can multiply very quickly. So getting a healthy plant, obviously, you're probably putting seedlings in, maybe having some chemical protection early on would be a useful thing. So having something like metalaxyl in the seedlings would be giving you early protection. From then on, it's trying to get good root growth and all those other factors we talked about, good drainage, irrigation scheduling, biological controls. I'd be looking at the compatible biological controls that you would have. So because metalaxyl will only work against the Pythium group, it won't knock over trichoderma, and similarly it won't attack or it won't affect the bacterial biocontrol. So you could use bacillus and trichoderma, or there's a pseudomonas available as well. So there's any one of those organisms, and I'd be putting them in.
So you're saying to use a chemical control, and because that's very specific on the Pythium, then you can put in these biologicals.
You can use these other things as well. So you want growth stimulation. Bacillus is really good at doing that. It actually produces growth stimulating hormone-like products. So
so useful. Len, is there any evidence that if you use the chemical control to knock out the Pythium and then add in the biological agents, that they'll fill that niche and make it harder for the Pythium to come back?
Yeah, well, that's what you're hoping to do, is to change the dominance in that root zone from where Pythium gets a toehold. You want to try and prevent that from day one, really. So assuming you've got good quality seedlings, and if quite often metal axle is either used as a seed dressing, but also it can be used at the seedling stage, to give you, because it's systemic, it'll be inside the root system, so that'll give you some early protection, but it won't last long once you put it in the field. The other aspect is soil organic matter, making sure you've got that rich. I think Graham Sterling, who's a nematologist up in Queensland around Bundaberg, did work years ago, and it might have included controlling Pythium. So you really need to have organic matter that's well composted in the soil. Fresh organic matter you probably want to steer away from, because, as I said in my talk, it's a bit of a substrate for Pythium if you're not careful.
So it does come back to those general soil health principles that
absolutely,
we're talking about. Just in terms of that, you know, fresh organic matter input, obviously compost that is not decomposed enough, that hasn't been allowed to decompose, compared to, say, a cover crop which you're incorporating, is that going to promote Pythium? So if you plough on a big sorghum crop and then plant your capsicums?
If you plant too quickly, I think you might have a chance. It needs maybe about 3 or 4 weeks. For again, if you've got good organic breakdown, so there's enough soil moisture there for that to occur, then you'll get that suite of organisms. And if you're using some biocontrols as well, then they'll tend to dominate. So there's ways through it.
Okay. We don't have any other questions, but I'm just going to ask Len to just really highlight the key intervention points for Pythium in terms of management, and then we'll wrap it up.
Well, it is really comes down to that integrated approach. So you've got very few chemical options. I guess with some of the work you guys have done with the SoilWealth, you've demonstrated that some of those biofumigants may be useful if you've got a problem. And you've got the ability to put a cover crop through, then they're obviously going to be very useful. But following up from that, I'd say, you've got those other cultural options, making sure you've got, you're not putting on too much water in one go, so you're better off having irrigations that are more frequent with less water than actually having inundative amounts of water that fill the soil profile to an extent, which reduce oxygen, particularly in warm conditions, and it'll favour Pythium over it. So it's this real balance in that area around the root, where you're wanting to, I guess, favour all of the beneficials over the pathogens like Pythium. And Pythium will be favoured under lower oxygen conditions, so you really want to avoid having conditions like that for too long. Any plant stress when it comes down to it, nutritional stress, things like those calcium supplements, if you can get those into the plant, that can be very useful as well. So some work that was done over in Ohio years ago showed that one of the factors that was very important where they found less disease of Pythium was where you had higher, I think I mentioned it, exchangeable cation levels in the soil, but it was primarily calcium and magnesium. So if you've got ways of making sure that calcium levels are getting to the plant to an optimal condition, then you'll have more resistance to infection.
Look, sorry, we have got a few more questions. I just wasn't moving the screen up, just a case of getting used to the technology. We've got a question from Dominic. Now, where have you gone, Dominic? With Len, there has been a suitable test with Pythium, and is there a way of testing that the beneficials are present and what levels will reduce the pathogen effect of Pythium? So I think that question's around, is there a way of...
Is there a test for beneficials?
Focusing on the disease, can you look at the beneficials? And
Look, I think... I don't know. There are people who reckon there are tests for, I guess, what's a healthy soil versus or what isn't. My feeling is it's always a bit more complicated than that, that we can kind of simplify things a bit too much sometimes with a simple test. As I said, there's many, many different organisms that can attack Pythium directly. Some of them can't be cultured, so you wouldn't really know. There's things called chytrids, which are things that I sometimes find in when I've cultured Pythium myself. I'll find they're actually infected with a chytrid, which knocks them out pretty quickly. So there's so many different things in soils that are actually doing stuff even without us knowing. I don't know that without some new generation gene sequencing technology that we could even deal with knowing at all.
It's certainly a good question, and I know, you know, in the universities there's a lot of work done looking at the sort of profile of that soil microbial populations.
Yeah, that's right. And I think that's where it's moving, and with using all these new tools that we might actually have something that can help. But again, it's so complex and they're so dynamic that I just don't know how realistic it is.
Right, we're going to jump to Simon, and Simon's asked a question around black plastic and temperature, and essentially what impact do you think that would have on Pythium? And I think he's asking is if it's laid ahead of planting, you know, would you get, say, solarisation? You know, would you heat up the soil and kill the pathogens?
Or? Yeah, unfortunately, I think the heating of the soil won't go deep enough. So I've read some reports, and again, you can't generalise because some species may be only in the top 15 centimetres. And I think even in the top 15 centimetres, if you've got black plastic, I don't know whether the temperature at 15 centimetres will be enough. For example, those two I mentioned, the high temperature ones, Pythium aphanidomatum and Pythium muriatilum, they can grow quite happily at 40 degrees. So if you can go down, if you can measure the temperature at 15 centimetres and it's going to have to be more than about 48 degrees for them to be killed. So that's the sort of thing you need.
So do you think you'll make it worse if you've got it black plastic in there? Or
it's hard to know because you'll start to get streptomycetes up near the surface, but then they'll be quite ephemeral. They'll disappear pretty quickly. But a lot of the streptomycetes can be beneficial. So you might actually get a partial solarization of the top 5 centimetres, say. Yeah. But I think below that, I'd say no overall.
So it's not going to improve it.
I think it might actually, it could even make it worse, because if the temperature comes down again and the streptomycetes die off, the Pythium will just come back up from down where it's surviving. So, yeah, and it's a bit like with fumigated soil. The Germans have a term, and it kind of translates to a slap in the face, where you fumigate, you clean everything, and then it comes back and the pathogens slap you in the face because they probably recolonise much quicker than the beneficials. So if you're not careful, I'd say you'd have to be putting things like trichoderma in if you were using that sort of semi-solarisation approach.
There's a follow-up from John saying that if you really want to heat the soil up to a great depth, then clear plastic's going to do the job better.
It would do better, yeah. And that, I mean, there is technology, which is solarisation, where that's been used. Although To be honest, I don't know that it's widely used anywhere in the world these days. A lot of work, you know, you'd think up in North Queensland it'd be viable, but it's not really used.
Here's a question from Andrew. How quickly after seeding is the Pythium likely to start?
Straight away. In fact, a lot of the work that's been done has shown that within a few hours of the little radical coming out, Pythium can start to attack if it's there and in high enough numbers, and the soil's wet and all that sort of thing. So there's those temperature requirements for the different species, obviously.
Well, we've got a follow-up question from Neil about his capsicums in Bundaberg, and I'm just going to have to read through this. If we're using companion, so there's a number of products
here. That's a Bacillus subtilis, yeah.
At 3 days, pre-plant, pre-transplant, and then again at 14 days.
Yeah.
So he's putting on the Bacillus twice.
Yeah.
And a humic acid in the same strategy, I presume it's at the same time.
Yeah.
Then using Agrifos and Metalaxyl.
Metalaxyl, right.
No, I'm just losing track of it. In between,
yeah.
Okay, in between those 3 and 14 days, can you suggest anything better?
So that's what you're doing now, and you're not getting control. I'd say.
There was a follow-up and he is saying the companion and Metalax are working very well, but are still getting some root stripping later on in growth.
Oh, later on. Okay. So maybe using one of the trichodermas that could go in later on, because you might find that as the root system gets bigger, you want a different approach. So maybe a trichoderma might be useful. I can't think of any chemical solution for you later on. You don't want to be putting chemicals on once you've got through. So all I could think is either reapplying the Bacillus or try a trichoderma treatment.
I'm just seeing, Neil, are you still there? I'm just, Neil, hand raised for 19 minutes. Okay, that's a new one for me. I'm going to unmute you, Neil, just so that you can have a conversation rather than typing. So let's try this. Okay, can you hear us, Neil? Oh. Neil, can you hear us?
Yeah, Kelvin.
Okay, so Neil, if you want to fire away with a question.
Yeah, so that was the question I asked was in relation to the put my hand up, I suppose. I just saw that little icon there. That was in relation to I'm learning the technology too. So, I suppose that was a strategy that we've used in one of our longest standing capsicum growers here with probably trying to integrate as much sort of technology as possible using the biocontrol, using rotations. A growing question is capsicum in relation to sugarcane and then break cropping with sorghum as green chop into the ground, plus also winter crop that his main issue is Pythium and nematode. Generally nematode is the primary soil infection pathogen, and then Pythium being I suppose the word would be saprophytic on top of that, so coming in secondary, or maybe the Pythium's first and nematode second, I'm not entirely sure.
I think it's one of those cases where you're getting that synergy between the two.
Yeah, that could be both in tandem, yeah. I suppose just seeing if there's anything else.
What about calcium supplements?
I suppose an explanation on that. Do you meaning calcium in any way possible or mainly topical? Or?
Well, I mean, do you... Can you put it in through the drip?
That's a factor of any fertigated crop, so it's all grown through trickle irrigation. So we're already using fertigation grade calcium sulfate, gypsum, calcium nitrate,
Okay, so they're going using.
Okay. They're using through the basically the whole cycle, the whole 110 days of the crop.
Okay, so you're already doing that.
Just if there's any other.
We're going to have to wrap up.
Yeah. Have you tried any of those other products that are more specific for nematode biocontrol?
As in like extracts, vegetable extracts?
Oh, no, there's... I've seen, I don't know where people get them, but there's one called Pycillomyces and a couple of other species, and they've been formulated and they seem to be available. I think I used one for root knot nematode once called Root Guard, and that's Root Guard. Have you heard of that?
Oh, I haven't actually on the supplier side of things, but just in Google searching, I'd heard Root Guard, but I don't think it was Australian.
I used it on some cucumbers once, and it gave me, back when we used to use Nemacur, and it gave me equal control to Nemacur, so it might be worth trialing something like that or one of, there's a few other products. I saw one recently where it had three different biologicals in it. And I Googled them all up, and they were all known overseas to control different aspects of the nematode life cycle. So
we're going to have to wrap it up because we're bang on time. I'm just going to share from Steve that some biologicals that are including Root Guard and neem oil and then the like. So you might need to follow up with those. I'll send them around as we finish. So thanks, Len, for the presentation. Thanks very much for the questions. That's been really great. We weren't quite sure how the technology would work, but apart from Neil having to keep his hand up for 19 minutes, I think we did pretty well. I'm just going to mute you again too. For a first attempt, I'm pretty happy with how it's gone. We'll certainly look at improving it. As part of the improvement process, when you shut down, the little survey will come up with some questions, about five questions. If you could take the time to address those, that would be great in terms of how we run these. Also, if you want to send Gordon any feedback in terms of just send him an email. So
thanks, guys.
For all the participants, thanks, Len. And
thanks for everyone. Yep.
We'll send out a notification once the transcript and the video is up on YouTube. We'll probably just send that out in our fortnightly emails maybe rather than inundating you with another one. And you certainly, any feedback on what the next webinar could be, that would be greatly appreciated. So thanks for all your participation.
Thanks, everybody.